letter writing is really important because it's one of your first introductions to the employer that you're applying for a position with. So it's not just your resume. Normally the first thing that they read is actually your cover letter, because that's the first thing that they see. That's your, hello, my name is, I'm applying for this position. And the reason that cover letters are so important is because they take it a step further than your resume does. Resumes a lot of times can look like a quick list. And in that list, you're just checking off things that you've done, showing them an employment history, giving them a little bit of background on where you've worked, what activities you've been involved in. But when you're writing a cover letter, you're actually communicating a little bit more about yourself, your ability to put into words full written phrases, full written sentences, exactly why you're interested in the position, why you would be a good fit for the position, and why you think they should hire you ultimately. And so cover letter writing is extremely important, and it falls into a special category of writing. When we talk about your resume, we're constantly hammering you about action verbs and, you know, using phrases and how your real estate matters so much, so don't put too much on the page. With a cover letter, it's slightly different because you're doing it in paragraph form, and you're probably going to be pasting it into an application document or into an email as you send it out for job applications. Now, I want to remind everyone that one other way that you can use a cover letter is as a networking document. So you may use this when you're emailing people and trying to find out about job opportunities. And so it's not always just a requirement for a job application. You may also be using it when you're trying to reach out to people. So with that said, let's start on what the format looks like. And the first thing that you, of course, want to consider is your address. So your first paragraph is, you know, who are you? So here you're just quickly saying, my name is, and I'm applying for. Now, how did you find it? So how did you find the position? So my name is Jennifer Dillenger. I'm applying for the assistant director position list that I found listed on your website. Were you connected to this opportunity by networking? Were you connected to this opportunity by a coach or a friend or, you know, a networking event? Did you find it just online? Did you see a tweet about it? How exactly did you find out about this opportunity? So this first paragraph is a really quick look at how you found the opportunity. Now, I'm going to try to put some quantity around how long this should be. So this paragraph really should not be more than 1 to 2 sentences. And I say that because you don't want to take up a lot of your space talking about more than simply who you are and what you're applying for. Also, don't use words like, I'm interested in learning more information about the position. You may be interested in learning more information, and that's what an interview might be for, but you really, what it comes down to is making sure that you're able to show them that you're applying for the opportunity. Now, the second paragraph is where we're going to get into more of the meat of who you are. And here, what you're looking at is giving them a summary of you. And so in this summary of you, this is where you get into more depth. I want to know about your knowledge, your skills, and your experience. Your knowledge is really just going to come down to what are your majors? You know, what are you majoring in? At this point, as a recent college graduate or an undergraduate, the only knowledge you can really lay claim to is that of your major. Your skills, do you have any specific skills? Can you use a specific computer program? Are you really capable in a certain lab or technical skill? Do you have a certification, CPR, first aid, that kind of thing that would be useful to the job you're applying for? So what are your skills? And then finally, what are your experiences? Now for some people, this might be part-time jobs, it might be internships, but it could also be things like, I've gained leadership skills skills, and again, what are those skills, through my experiences as a Division I athlete. It might be through leadership positions that you've had on campus. It may be through community volunteer work. So your experience doesn't have to be tied to part-time jobs or internships, but you need to be able to show what you've learned and what you're bringing to that organization through these skills, experiences, and knowledge. Now, a lot of people look at this paragraph and go, I don't even really know where to begin. Just write. Start by writing. It is so much easier to get words on a page and start saying some things that summarize you. And if that takes you a whole page, then at least you've got a starting point. Then you want to go back through and you want to call out, how can I boil down what took me five sentences to say into a single sentence? So sometimes more is a lot better to start with so that you can start editing down. And that's a really great place to start. But this summary of you is going to be a little bit longer on your cover letter. It may be a total of 3 to 4 sentences. So again, a lot of people are fairly good at talking about their skills, experience, and knowledge because, again, it's you, and it's the things that you've done over the past 4 years. Now we're going to move into the third paragraph, and what's really important here, and what I really want you to understand more than anything else about cover letter writing, is the third paragraph is your when. It's where you're going to connect you to the company, the job, and the industry that you're applying for. You're not going to tell them how interested you are in their leadership program. You're not going to talk about how great of an opportunity this would be for you. You're not even going to mention how truly awesome or wonderful or fun or exciting it would be to work for them. Because guess what? They know that. They know that they've got a good program. They know that there are people interested in this opportunity. They know that they've got 10 other great applicants. They know that. You've got to show how you fit with their culture, how you're bringing something to the table, and how you're going to be a benefit to them overall, and that you're worth the investment of time and resources to get you up to speed as a member of their team. So this is really how you win the job opportunity, is by putting into words for them how you're a fit for their company. So in the third paragraph, this is where I call you connecting you to them. So this is where you make an overt mention of how your skills, experience, and knowledge are a fit with their industry, their company or organization, and the job specifically. Now, how do you do this? Their industry, it might be as simple as mentioning again your background in finance. If you're applying for a job in investment management and you mention that you've taken an investment management course, if you're interested in real estate and you took a commercial real estate course, or you were certified in real estate, that would be a way of connecting you to their industry. Their company, what makes them unique? Is it a startup company? Is it an older, established company that is all about tradition and all about, you know, understanding where you come from and working up the totem pole? Is it the kind of culture where you're going to wear the jeans to work every day and they're all about innovation and creativity and fun? What is their company about and how do you fit into that? And so you're going to mention ways that you can fit into that. And then the job specifically. When you read that job description, does it tell you you need to be detail oriented? Does it say things like seeking a qualified applicant who's interested in organization, who's interested in creativity, who's interested in developing programs or structure, who's interested in completing analysis? You know, what are the things that stand out to you in that job, and how specifically do your skills, experience, and knowledge fit with that? So you're going to take 3 or 4 sentences here that are going to connect you to that job. Now, a lot of people would say that all you need is this paragraph here. Well, if I tell them about me, why don't I just take 2 paragraphs telling them about me? I can go into more depth. I can tell them all about what I've done in my background. The reason you don't want to do that is you're then leaving it up to them to make the leap to the belief that you're a fit. You don't want to leave that to chance. You want to make those connections yourself. You want to show them that you're a great fit. So you might say something like, my skills, experience, and knowledge are a fit for your culture and your company, and specifically this job. My background being a Division I athlete has taught me work ethic. And looking at your position, you need someone that's got a strong drive to achieve and succeed in any project put before them. Your culture demands that you be creative, and I bring a creativity to the table that I learned during my experience being a consultant or being a leader in this position. And so you're pulling the things that maybe you might have alluded to up here, and you're connecting them to their opportunity. So three paragraphs down, one more to go. You've got a final paragraph where you're going to conclude everything. You're going to tell them thank you because you still appreciate the fact that they've read your cover letter and are giving you a chance. And you also want to mention that you've attached your resume. So you want to attach your resume, make sure you mention that. You want to thank them. And then you kind of want a final call to action. And in this call to action, what you're interested in doing is saying, what's next? What are the next action steps that I need to take? What am I interested in accomplishing? And so you're hoping for an interview. So here you might say, I'm really interested in talking about possible times to conduct an interview or complete an interview, or I see that the job is open until the end of October. I look forward to hearing from you soon, and if you're unable to follow up, I'll try to reach back out in mid-November. So that's your call to action. I'm letting you know that I'm so interested that if you don't reach out to me, I'm planning to reach back out to you. This is really brief. Again, 1 to 2 sentences at the most. You're not going to take a lot of time. And then you're going to end with a salutation. Thank you, or I appreciate the opportunity. Best, some people sign it best. Sincerely always works and is always acceptable. And your name. Couple things. Your cover letter needs to be copied and pasted into an email if you're applying for a job through email. Do not write a cover letter, attach it and your resume, and write an awkwardly stilted introductory email that says, I'm attaching my cover letter and my resume. Instead, you want to make sure that this goes into the body of the email. Occasionally, you will have someone submit a job, or you'll be reading a job application, and it will say, just submit your resume here. If it does not require a cover letter, write one anyway. What I talked about earlier is how this is your true introduction. It's an opportunity to show your writing ability. It's an opportunity to really communicate how you want this job and you're interested in this particular job. Write a cover letter for it. I can almost promise there's somewhere on that job application that you can upload it. And all they're going to do if they don't want to see it is throw it away. But if they are of the mindset to read through it, they're going to be impressed that you took that additional step to prove that you're a fit for this job. Not just I'm showing you my resume, but I've taken time to craft, to wordsmith something that is specifically for this job and your company. Now, I mentioned a little bit earlier that you can use a cover letter as a networking document, that you can use it to reach out to people that you haven't met before or maybe that you met in the past. I just want to go back through the four paragraphs and go over a few things that you may want to keep in mind if you're using this format for a networking purpose. Going back to this first paragraph, still very much who you are. You know, my name is Jennifer Dillenger. I'm a senior at Wofford College where I'm majoring in English. Second piece isn't how did I find the position, it's how did I find their information. So I promise I'm not a weirdo, I'm not someone that's just come out of nowhere. I found your information on Wofford's alumni network. I was given your information by my faculty member who works in the finance department at Wofford. I'm reaching out to you because my roommate suggested that you would be a good contact since he worked for you this past summer. So you need to always explain who you are and how you got their information. That's going to keep them reading the rest of your email, the rest of your cover letter. In that second paragraph, you're still going to do that summary of you, but there needs to be some understanding of why you're reaching out to this person. You know, I'm interested in the finance industry, and so you would start with that simple sentence of who you are, kind of why are you reaching out to them. And then finally, in that third paragraph, again, it's about connecting you to them. So how exactly are you connected to them? And there are four ways that you can be connected to a networking contact. And so I think it's really important that you remember these. One, their job is a job that you want one day. If there are recent graduates, they're management trainees, or serving as financial analysts, or they're working in an entry-level position, they may have graduated 1 to 2 years ago, you want to reach out to them because they have a job that you want. So that's one reason. Second reason, they work at a company you want to work for. Anyone that works at Michelin becomes a networking contact. Anyone that works at Milliken, if that's a target for me. Anyone that works at a certain law firm or accounting firm. But if they work at a company you're interested in, that becomes your connection to them and why you're reaching out to them. Third one is the industry. Now, sometimes you may not be able to find Wofford alumni or connections in a job or a company that you're interested in, but they're a part of that industry overall. For example, let me throw out a kind of hard industry. If you're interested in aviation or aeronautics, our 14,000 living alum may not host a large percentage of alums that work in that industry, much less a company or a job that falls into that industry that's a fit. So instead, I'm reaching out to everyone that I can find that falls in that industry. Now, they might be a personal assistant in that industry, they might work in a different department than what I'm interested in, but overall, they're a member of that industry by some association. So that would be the third way. Now, the fourth way, and the least ironclad and probably the weakest way to be connected to someone is going to be location. So I'm not going to reach out to someone if I don't have a job in common with them, a company in common with them, or an industry in common with them. But if I'm looking at a city that's extremely difficult to find connections in or find Wofford connections in, what I might be interested in targeting is simply their location. Let's say I'm interested in moving to Fargo. Fargo, North Dakota. So I'm interested in moving there. And I want to work in finance in Fargo. Now that might not be a great plan, but for some reason I can't find someone that works in a job I want, or in a company I want, or even in an industry I want. But guess what? Wofford has four alumni that live in Fargo. One of them is a chef. One of them is a policeman, and two of them are somehow unemployed, but they are self-employed, I should say. But we've got four. They're none of them working in finance, but I want to reach out to those four because guess what? Fargo's really not that big, and more than likely they're going to know people in Fargo that work in finance and be able to connect me to those networks there. So again, location is not the strongest way to connect with someone, but it can be useful if you're targeting a very specific area. In that final paragraph, from a networking standpoint, I want you to again attach your resume, thank them for taking the time to read your networking request, and then you're still going to put in a call to action. This one's a little bit different though. It's not one that's simply, you know, I'm applying for this job, I'm interested in learning more about job opportunities you might have. A call to action in a networking standpoint needs to be very specific and it needs to be easy to respond to. If you're networking, you don't want to say, I appreciate any help you can offer me. That's extremely broad and it's easy to say no to. So instead, your call to action needs to be something like, will you review my resume and offer some feedback on how I can make it better applicable to the jobs that I'm interested in, that I've mentioned in these other two paragraphs? Could you suggest for me a couple follow-up connections that might be able to point me in the right direction in my job search? Would you be available for a 15-minute phone conversation? That's a very specific call to action that I'm more than likely going to say yes to because it's not hard. You're not asking me to guarantee you a job. You're not asking me for some vague help. What does that mean? you're simply saying, can we talk for 15 minutes? So if you put out there a specific call to action, your whole networking email or networking contact letter is going to be more warmly received and more than likely going to gain you a response. So overall, this is a very brief and quick look at the structure of a cover letter that can be morphed into a networking email. The best thing that you can do is get started. Start writing, try to put it in these four paragraphs, and then get someone to read it. After you've started culling it down to, you know, 3 to 4 sentences per paragraph, 1 and 2 on the first and fourth, but you're gonna start culling it down. You never wanna send a cover letter that's more than 3/4 of a page at the max. Your format, as far as the actual structure, the typefacing and stuff, is never going to be as important as the content. So really go over that with a fine-tooth comb. Always remember to follow up with a career coach and find somebody to proof it, and they'll be willing to help you and offer feedback and keep improving your writing style.